Now listen, do me a favor, sit down, be calm. We want to play music. Please be comfortable so that we can play music. Sedute, per favore.
Yeah, bring the band down behind you, boys. All right, this is Mike Genovese, along with my buddy Marc Atkinson. And we're thrilled to bring you podcast number one of Everything Zappa.
In this first podcast, Mike and I are going to focus solely on the incredible, the amazing masterwork entitled Shut Up and Play Your Guitar. So, without further ado, podcast number one.
Marc, how you doing?
I'm doing great, Mike. Great intro. How you doing?
Really excited. This is fun for me. I really enjoy doing this. One of the my favorite things in life is to talk about Frank, and to get to do it for an hour at a time is pretty cool. Maybe perhaps since this is podcast number one, we should just tell briefly who we are.
Okay, my name is Marc Atkinson, born and raised in Toronto, Ontario, Canada. Became a Zappa fan probably around the age of 16, I think, when I got my first Zappa record, which was Tinseltown Rebellion. And then shortly after that, I got Joe's Garage. And it's funny, because back then, you couldn't just walk into any record store and get a Frank Zappa album. You had to either go to a used record store, or you had to find someone that had it and tape it from them. That was the only way you could get his music back then in Canada anyways. Shortly after that, I went to Berklee School of Music for drums, which is where I met Mike. And it was there that Mike had me go to Strawberries, which is a used record store. And that's where we found Shut Up and Play Your Guitar. And I heard it for the first time.
Yeah, okay. Well, I'm from Stamford, Connecticut, which is pretty close to New York City. And Marc is a drummer, and I'm a I used to be a trumpet player. Not anymore, really. I play mostly piano. But anyway, Marc and I were both aspiring musicians, and I was a senior in high school, so I was just turning 17, and my cousin played me Joe's Garage, and I thought, what a concept. The guy's talking between songs, and he's telling a story, and it was funny, and it was interesting, and it was important, and the music was crazy. And so I fell in love with Frank right then. And that was only about 6 to 9 months before I went to Berklee. Marc came a few months later after I did, and the first thing I did was I knocked on my old friend's door, Andrew, his name was, and Marc answered the door, and I said, hey, who are you? He said, I'm Andrew's new roommate. And Marc had a Chunga's Revenge album cover t-shirt on. And I said, oh, yeah, you like Frank, huh? Yeah, all right. Yeah. But anyway, after that, Marc and I became great friends and roommates later on. And just, Zappa was our central focal point in life. But also, you know, we developed a friendship, outside of Frank. But we had a good time up at school. And yeah, I think I took you to, I don't know, Strawberries. I don't know why I get the credit for this, but you found the Shut Up album, and I think, was that the first time you'd ever heard it?
Yeah, it was. We walked into it. What I loved about it, first off, was the way it was presented, the big box set, and it had like three records in it. And I was a huge Tinseltown Rebellion fan. I remember really freaking out over the drums in Easy Meat. And to this day, I still freak out over what was played in that solo on Tinseltown. And I remember, I just recalled you telling me, if you like the solo stuff in Tinseltown, you're going to love this album because that's all it is. And I remember we found it. We grabbed it and we went back. Did we go back? Yeah, we went back to the dorms and
listened to it. Well, we had to borrow somebody's turntable, first of all.
That's right.
And if I remember, it was on the Orange label. It wasn't Barking Pumpkin. It was the Orange label, whatever that was. And, I remember listening to it for the first time with you in the room. And And then you became the aficionado on that record. And it turned out that, in my opinion, matches yours, that that's one of the most important Frank albums there is.
Well, musically, it's one of the most important albums there is, period. Not just Frank, but just period. And every musician on the planet should own this album and do yourself a favor and study the living crap out of it. Because I still study it. I still hear things on that album that I hadn't heard before, or little intricate conversations, musical conversations between Vinny and Frank. And the way they communicate musically is just outstanding. It's unparalleled.
Well, in general, that's one of the greatest things about Frank. It was 1986 when I first started listening to Frank, so it's close to 30 years now. And I can just last week, I heard something on an album that I didn't notice before. And of course, that happens a lot with the Shut Up album. But, you know, not just the Shut Up album, but that is one that has a lot of stuff that you could just listen to it forever.
So with that in mind, let's dig in. Let's start right at the top. And what we want to do is we want to go through song by song. And as we're going through them, we're going to play audio examples and to emphasize what we're saying. And again, this is Mike and I's opinion of what we think and or what we've learned over the years listening to this record, and also talking to other musicians and also ex-Zappa alumni, and actually some of the people that played on this record. So we're going to throw all that out there and, take it from there.
For anybody, and I know there's other people in the world who love this kind of stuff as well, and if we spew any misinformation, because we don't know everything, please feel free. We encourage you to give us what you believe to be the right. If we get something, in other words, we get something wrong, straighten us out.
Track one is, of course, 555. Lowercase five, lowercase five in terms of the lettering, and then all caps five. So first, before we get into all the other, the recording date and where it was played, etc., let's first talk about the title. Why is it lowercase, lowercase, and then, capitalized five? Where does that come from?
Well, that's from the time signature of the piece, or time signatures. The pattern is two bars of 5/8, followed by one bar of 5/4.
Right. Okay. And it was recorded 2/17/1979 at the Odeon Hammersmith in London. Is that a correct date and correct location?
Yes, it is. Yep.
Okay. Now, where did this originate from? Where did the song come from?
It comes out of Conehead.
He's calling me. She ain't really dumb. She's just a conehead.
Tater chip crumbs all over her face. Is there any more beer stashed away in her place?
She's just a conehead.
Which is really rare. It didn't happen before. Prior to that, I'm not sure. Am I wrong? I think that was the first time that Frank called that while they were in the middle of Conehead.
So he called, they played it as a solo section to Conehead.
Right, right. After some other soloing, then he gave the signal, I guess, to play that pattern.
Now, was that something he did with that particular tune a lot, or did it just happen on this particular recording?
No, that's pretty much a one-shot deal as far as I know. I can't find it anywhere else. I can't find it anywhere else in the 1979 tour on any of the recordings that I have.
Well, it was played in Manchester in 79 after it was in Pound for a Brown.
Right.
So you're talking coming out of Conehead, it was a one-shot deal.
As far as I know, that's correct, yeah.
Okay.
The one you're referring to in Manchester on February 12th, I think, is it comes out of Pound, and then they play a few other things, and then it goes to 555. Right? Don't they play 13,
correct.
And then it's Deathless Horsey, and then 555. But that's what I know.
Track two is Hog Heaven. '18, 1980, the Brady Theater in Tulsa, Oklahoma.
Right. Now, the funny thing about Hog Heaven, which happens to be the solo section from Easy Meat, which is the, at that time, the slow 3-4 E Lydian. It's actually two recordings. Frank only listed one location, but in the middle of the solo, he cuts to another concert. I would never have known it myself unless I listened to the original bootleg recording of it. And I would never know. And as a matter of fact, I listened to that same track for what, 20, 25 years, and never realized they came from two different locations. Because number one, they're rhythmically similar.
Right.
And number two, because they're only a couple nights apart. And usually when Frank cuts from one solo to, like, when he cuts from something from a one night to maybe a few nights later, they're still playing it sort of the same. So it's not going to be a dramatic change. And plus, his edits are just so good. They're so beautiful that it's almost impossible to tell that there's a splice. Now that I know that there is one, I can kind of hear it.
Right.
But you'd never know it unless you listen to the original bootleg recordings. Now, it's a mystery, although it's guessed. A lot of people think that it might be Dallas, Texas, which I think was the night before. But the beginning of the solo, Frank is playing with an octave divider. And so you hear a lot of, you know, low notes. And then at one point he turns it off and he plays a glissando, and it goes into the regular octave. And that's where the edit occurs, and it's a different location. I'd like to one day find a source of that concert and listen to the, you know, the way it originally was.
Yeah, and I'd love to, if anyone out there knows where the second part of the solo comes from, for sure, 100%, let us know.
Yeah, absolutely.
Track three is Shut Up and Play Your Guitar. '18, 1979, Odeon Hammersmith, London. Where did the song come from, and are those dates and locations correct?
Yep, the date, location, correct. The second day at the Odeon. He played 3 days at the Odeon, four shows. On the 18th, they played two shows. And Shut Up and Play Your Guitar, the song, as well as Shut Up and Play Your Guitar Some More, and Return of the Son of Shut Up and Play Your Guitar. Those three tracks
yeah.
are the solo section from Inca Roads.
Okay.
And there's also a tune that we're going to get to later on, but I'll jump to it right now, called Gee, I Like Your Pants. And that's also from Inca Roads. But they played two shows on the 18th. And so one is from the early show and one is from the late show.
Now, which one's from which?
I can't say offhand, but I think Gee, I Like Your Pants is from the day show, the early show. And I think Shut Up and Play Your Guitar Some More is from the night show.
So the interesting thing is, though, they're from the same day, but the tone and the whole sound of each solo is drastically different. Do you think that was intentional?
I think it was absolutely intentional. Frank beefed up the shut-ups, the three shut-up cuts, with lots of reverb and made it very majestic sounding. And then the G, I Like Your Pants solo is very thin and dry, and I think that was intentionally done to differentiate those three tracks from that one track. And that, coming from the Inca Roads song is, of course, the vamp, which goes from C major to D major back and forth, which creates the C Lydian mode, which is one of Frank's favorite modes.
Track number three, While You Were Out. Recording date, interestingly enough, is unknown, but the location is Los Angeles, California. So I'm going to hazard a guess that this was, in fact, I'm almost positive this was recorded during the Joe's Garage, the summer of 79 when they did Joe's Garage. What would you say?
Well, yeah, I've heard that it's actually two different sessions. One of them is like late spring, and then overdubs, which I think are drums, is summer, which was when the Joe's Garage sessions began, because that piece consists of three musicians, Frank on lead guitar, and then Warren Cucurullo playing the rhythm guitar, the drone, which is in D major, or, well, it's some sort of D, and where he actually tunes his E string down to D and plays the background for Frank. I think, I'm not sure, but it appears as if Frank and Warren played and just played and played for a little while. And then when Vinny came to the studio in the summer, Frank just instructed him to play all kinds of different beats and different time signatures and so forth, some of which became other songs, and then most of which made it onto those two tracks, While You Were Out, and then later on in the album, Stucco Homes. They're all from the same sessions. We had talked about this before, Marc and I, that the title of the piece, While You Were Out, Frank said it's merely just a reference to those little pink slips of paper that they use in offices. But it kind of also makes sense that While You Were Out is an appropriate name, because when you know, Vinny recorded, the other guys weren't there, and vice versa. So it's kind of like the epitome of Frank's Xenocrony situations. The drum tracks ended up in two different places, or a couple of different places. Frank instructed him to play in 11/8, which was the vamp for what became Outside Now. It was originally the vamp to City of Tiny Lights on the 1979 tour. The vamp for Outside Now on the Joe's Garage album. But he would make Vinny play. And then those same tracks became part of While You Were Out and Stucco Homes, the same exact tracks. He would duplicate them and put them in all different places. And lots of times, multiple times, if you listen to Stucco Homes, you'll hear the same drum lick over and over. It's the same recording. It's not that Vinny played the same thing twice. Frank just spliced it up so that it was, you know, he was just recycling and recycling and recycling. And so that's why the drum tracks are identical in places on He Used to Cut the Grass, Outside Now on the Joes album, and While You Were Out in Stucco Homes.
And you've got something from Warren Cucurullo, right? You have a story that actually Warren tells about the exact session. So let's start. What did Frank kind of instruct Vinny to do?
He had Vinny... He instructed Vinny to play several things in the studio. One of them was that vamp and a few other things. So Warren was listening to Inca Roads, which is the C major, D major vamp. And then he just, you know, after that, Warren was able to sit in the control room and just watch Frank work his magic. And he says after that, Frank improvised, sitting at the desk, playing an acoustic Black Widow guitar. I'd never seen or heard of one before. I was playing an unusual guitar as well. It was Frank's Vox Winchester, which he decided should be my payment for the session. And so Warren's payment was the guitar. He got the guitar, and he got to watch Frank, you know, do his magic. And he said, anyway, Frank blew this down in one take, no punches. What a night. Frank Zappa is the greatest thing that ever happened to music, and I agree.
Okay, so Mike did a little legwork and found some similarities in the drum parts, well, exact similarities in the drum parts in these four tunes. So here's some samples. What I did was I took – the first sample is He Used to Cut the Grass and While You Were Out. And I basically found one of Mike's points where the drums match up. And what I've done is I've lined them up audially and panned one right and one left. You'll be able to hear drums almost like they're in the middle because they're exactly the same in both tracks. And on the right, you'll hear Frank's guitar on one of them. And on the left, you'll hear Frank's guitar on the other. So check it out. Okay, the next little sample is you're going to hear Outside Now, then right into Stucco Homes, then right into While You Were Out, and all the drums are the same. Check it out.
Treacherous Cretins. Recording date was 2/17/1979, again at the Odeon Hammersmith in London. This is its own entity, right? It's its own thing. It never came out of anything. It was, what, a show opener?
Yeah, as far as I know, it was always used as an opener to a show, and it was just, you know, its own thing, that the eight-note vamp or whatever it was. Well, actually, later on in the tour... they changed the vamp to an 11/8 vamp. It's normally in 4/4, and then they decided to just add three notes to it and make it a little different. It actually sounds like this. Yeah, that was a concert opener, because Frank liked to open most of his shows on most of his tours with very simple structures that he and the band could get loose over. And so if there was any butterflies or something, you know, you'd get your acts warmed up, and also it was a good time for the members of the band to really stretch out. And Frank would often say that was the best time for them to get all that stuff out of their system and then concentrate on playing the show proper.
Next track, Heavy Duty Judy. May 5, 1980 at the Berklee Community Theater. Correct date, correct place?
Yes, absolutely. Funny story about this is it originally, on the 1980 tour, started as some sort of coda to The Torture Never Stops. Now, it came as at the end. They would play Torture Never Stops for about 15, 20 minutes, and then all of a sudden this vamp would start out of nowhere, and then Frank would solo on it for, you know, a couple of minutes. The funny part about Heavy Duty Judy was that the head was written a year or two later. Offhand, I can't remember what tour he played it on, but I know for sure that it was played in 84. And it had a head proper, just like the one you hear on from the 1988 band on The Best Band You Never Heard in Your Life. You know, Heavy Duty Judy has a head and then a solo section. Well, it was originally just a solo section, head written later. And that's all that is. And so it eventually became its own song, but was originally the coda to The Torture Never Stops.
Soup and Old Clothes, which we discussed earlier, 12/11/1980, Santa Monica Civic Auditorium.
It comes from the Illinois Enema Bandit.
Which, incidentally, is the last song that Vinny ever played with Frank. Santa Monica, Illinois Enema Bandit.
Yeah, that's right. I think that was the last song of the night. And then they did a little funny thing on that in the last couple of shows of that tour, where they would turn the beat around for the solo section, and they would come out of that shuffle, slow shuffle thing, and make it like a proper 4/4. You know, that little dee da 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 da. That was what happened as a result of, you know, touring. And also, they would use it on later tours as well. I know at Halloween 1981, they play Illinois Enema Bandit. And then when that solo section comes around, they play that little ditty as well.
Variations on the Carlos Santana secret chord progression. May 17, 1980. Dallas Civic Arena.
Okay, that's, for some reason, that's an incorrect date. That song comes from the same exact concert as Soup and Old Clothes. The 11th of December, 1980 Santa Monica. And that is a song. That song is the solo section to City of Tiny Lights. City of Tiny Lights went through many permutations. The solo section did, at least over the years. Started off as just the regular vamp that you hear on Cheeky Booty. Flat seven going to one. Right. Just very simple. Somewhere around the 79 tour, they decided to change it up, or Frank decided, and the solo would start like that, only Denny Wally would play a slide solo over that for a little while, and then the band would drift into this little nebulous part where all kinds of sound effects would happen, and then Arthur Barrow would start to play the what we talked about before, the Outside Now vamp. The 11-8 Outside Now vamp. And then it became, when they played in 1980, the solo section for Frank became the Carlos Santana secret chord progression. The name of that song, what is it? Oye Como Va?
Also, something to note here is in the 1980 tour, there was no percussion, no Ed Mann on this tour. So, do we have any? Do we know any the reason why he didn't, you know, do that tour? Do you know?
As far as I know, he was splitting his time between teaching at a college. It was either in Virginia or it might have even been the Curtis Institute in Philadelphia, but I'm not really sure. I know he was teaching percussion somewhere on the East Coast, and I think it was just because he was splitting his time. I don't think it had any. There was nothing deeper than that.
Next up, we discussed this earlier, Gee, I Like Your Pants, 1879, Odeon Hammersmith, London. Inca Roads, right? Yeah, another Inca.
Yeah.
So we've already kind of covered that one. Okay, this one's interesting. Canarsie, 1979, Odeon Hammersmith, London.
Canarsie.
So it's the day after one of the shut-ups in Gee, I Like Your Pants, and it's this is what I don't understand. Okay, a couple questions. On Gee, I Like Your Pants, it's Arthur Barrow on bass. On Canarsie, it's Patrick O'Hearn on bass. Care to elaborate on that little tidbit there?
Well, I know that I've heard that it's actually from a sound check from that day. I'm not quite sure if it was something that occurred during the show or during the sound check, but I know that there's overdubs that were done later on over the summer at Village Recorders. And I just had never been, I was never sure which instruments were overdubbed and you know, which ones were on the basic tracks.
Oh, so you think Patrick O'Hearn was part of the overdub?
Yeah, because okay. Well, Patrick was part of the
Joe's Garage recordings,
right?
So yeah, just to paint the picture, just to make this clear, the original lineup, which would be Warren Cucurullo, Denny Wally, Ike Willis, Tommy Mars, Peter Wolf, Arthur Barrow, Ed Mann, Vinnie Colaiuta, and Patrick O'Hearn, in the summer of 79, go into the studio and record Joe's Garage. While they're in there, out of those sessions comes parts of Canarsie, correct?
Yes.
Parts of Stucco Homes,
mm-hmm.
or all of Stucco Homes, and all of While You Were Out.
That's right.
Yeah, so there's the. I'm just trying to make it, you know, trying to draw a picture here.
Right. Now, we know that the original intent was just to go there and record Joe's Garage. And also, I think he wanted to record Catholic Girls. And now, I'm not sure, but I think that Frank just had the band play the instrumental tracks for My Guitar Wants to Kill Your Mama. I'm not sure if he had any intention of releasing it, or maybe it was just a way to get the band to warm up and gel. But those basic instrumental tracks for My Guitar ended up being the Central Scrutinizer. And if you listen closely and you ignore the Central Scrutinizer, you can sing along.
And your mama jumped out screaming, "Don't go back, you won't. Can't take it. I want to kill your mama. My guitar wants to kill your mama. My guitar wants to burn you dead. I get real mean when it makes me mad. Later I'll try to call you. Your mama told me you just were there.
That's really interesting. That's very cool. I did not know that. See, there's something else. I learned something else. Okay, so next up is Ship Ahoy. Which is, recording date is unknown, but it's in Tokyo or Osaka, Japan. So elaborate on that.
Well, as far as I know, that...
I would think you could look at the lineup. It's 76, right? It's got...
Well, yeah, it's most definitely February. It's most definitely February 3rd, Osaka, Japan.
Yeah.
But you could... Go ahead. Who's on the lineup?
Yeah, it's FZ, Andre Lewis, Roy Estrada, and Terry Bozzio. That gives it away right there.
Yeah. I mean, no, there's no doubt. I don't know why it's unknown, because as far as I've always known, it's Osaka, the same night that Black Napkins, the famous Black Napkins on Zootalores, was recorded.
And Frank really didn't care about dates or lineups or anything like that. That's more of a fan thing. Isn't that right?
Well, yeah, it's always like that with composers. They just do their thing, and then they try to label the stuff as best as they can. But often, tape boxes are not labeled right, or they just forgot to do them. They got lazy, and stuff is not stored correctly. And so Frank did the best he can, you know, in labeling stuff. But, you know, diehard, hardcore fans who have the bootleg tapes and stuff, we know, you know, what's right and what's wrong. And so, yeah, we're the ones that care about it. Frank never cared about that, but we're the ones who are, you know, sticklers on when something was recorded. And it's important to know, because it's important to know the chronology of this stuff what happened first, what happened next, and what was developed from what. So I think it's, you know, good what we're doing.
Yeah.
But yeah, so that Ship Ahoy from Osaka, Japan, February 3rd, is the, on the Shut Up and Play Your Guitar album, it's the earliest live recording that there is. And Ship Ahoy was always on the 76 tour, the coda to Zoot the Lures.
Next up, Deathless Horsey. To 1979, the Odeon Hammersmith, and this is its own song. It didn't come from anything. It just, what, opened up most of the shows, right?
Yes, it was a show opener, and that particular night, it was, I think on the 78 tour, sometimes Frank would just start it impromptu. But it became a steady opener on that tour, as far as I know. And the interesting thing about that exact recording, is that right where he cuts it and it goes into another song is when they start playing the Diseases of the Band Vamp. And it's if you listen to Volume 1 of You Can't Do That on Stage, Diseases of the Band, that's right where it picks up. Does the band introductions, but yeah, the Deathless Horsey opened the shows, a lot of the shows.
Next up, Shut Up and Play Your Guitar Some More. June 17, 1979, Odeon Hammersmith.
Yes. Now, the interesting thing about that, for those who have the Frank Zappa guitar book, the one that Steve Vai transcribed, that was originally the first solo, Shut Up and Play Your Guitar, because it was recorded on the 17th. So he was going to go right in order and have the 17th, 18th, and 19th. But for some reason, he chose the 18th to be Shut Up and Play Your Guitar, and then Shut Up and Play Your Guitar Some More was on the 17th, the day before. Hence, the mistake in the guitar book where they're both tunes are labeled wrong. They have the opposite.
That's not the only mistake in that book.
Right. And Steve Vai must have transcribed those songs before the release of the album.
Next up is Pink Napkins, 2/17/1977, the Odeon Hammersmith. And this comes out of, obviously, Black Napkins, but this is a small part of a larger, much larger solo. Is that correct?
Yeah, that's happens to be the last date on the 76-77 tour. And yeah, that's back when Black Napkins was really long, because he would have Eddie Jobson play a very long violin solo on it, and then he would come in later. And obviously the reason why it's called Pink Napkins is because it's a very soft, very, you know, smooth solo, but it is not the entire solo. If you listen to the bootleg recording, Frank fades it out before it gets louder and more aggressive, and it turns into something that's really beautiful. I wish he'd released the entire thing, but he didn't.
I sat and listened to this. I hadn't visited that bootleg in a long time, and I sat and listened to it again last night. And I strongly encourage anyone out there, if they haven't done so, to find that bootleg, because it's fantastic. The solo, well, all his solos are great, but this one is really, really great.
Especially because he keeps it subdued for a very long time, and then it just turns into this majestic solo for another 5 minutes or so. It's really wonderful.
Yeah, yeah. All right, our next track is Beat It With Your Fist. The Palladium, New York City, which very famous, his Halloween show. So it's obviously the night before, but it's, you know, during that time. What can you tell us about this one? What does it come from?
It's from Torture Never Stops. And for some, I mean, Frank was playing long solos on the Torture Never Stops back in the on the 80 tour, long solos. For some reason, he chose to edit that down to about a minute and something. I have no idea why, but that's all that is, just a very foreshortened, edited version of the solo from Torture Never Stops.
You can't help but wonder if some of the edits on this record or this collection are due to the time limitations back then, because he had to put it on vinyl. And I just, you know, can't imagine what he would be coming out with today with technology the way it is now.
That's very true. I don't know. You know, there's a debate about one solo in particular, and that's the one from One Size Fits All, the Inca Road solo from Helsinki, Finland. I believe that the edits in that one, to turn a solo that's about 6 minutes long into a solo that's about maybe 3 minutes long for the record, was because of the limitations of vinyl. People like, I know Mike Keneally wrote a little essay a number of years ago that, no, that's not the reason. It was artistic reasons. It was that, you know, there were certain parts that weren't needed, or reached the climax too soon, or was just wanking or whatever. So there's always the debate, you know, why did Frank do this? Why did he do that? Why did he put that weird cut in Deathless Horsey? You know, there's a funny edit on Deathless Horsey on the Shut Up Play Guitar album. We don't know if that's artistic reasons or something happened to the tape, or, you know, you'll never know the answer to some of those questions.
Okay, next up, Return of the Son of Shut Up and Play Your Guitar. 2/19/1979, the Odeon Hammersmith in London, again from Inca Rhodes. Anything else you want to add to this one?
No, except for that's by far my favorite of the three, because it's nice and long, and he starts it off with the octave divider. Well, no, actually, he kicks it in somewhere in the middle.
Yeah, where the band starts to get real funky. It's great.
Just takes his time with this one. It's just so beautiful.
Next track is Pinocchio's Furniture. /12/5/1980, Berklee Community Theater.
Yeah, just a concert opener, Chunga's Revenge. Very simple.
My personal favorite off the collection, Why Johnny Can't Read, 2/17/1979.
This one is kind of funny. Frank made a funny, interesting edit on this one. This is from Pound for a Brown. And after some soloing by the other guys, Frank starts to play a solo, but the band comes down. And then, if you listen to the album, it's kind of a... It sounds as if it's free, but I believe they're vamping in 13. But it's very soft and subdued. It's tough to hear. But then Frank reaches a climax along with the band, and then they bring it back down again. And Frank cuts that entire climax out. So within the first 15 seconds of the song, Frank makes an edit to the second beginning of the second climax. And that's just, I thought that was interesting why he would do that. That was probably due to the vinyl limitations. And if you get a chance to listen to that bootleg, you'll see that it should have stayed in if it could have.
Okay, the next track is Stucco Homes. Obviously, the recording date is unknown, but the Joe's Garage sessions once again.
Yeah, well, keep in mind, it's actually two sessions. There's one session that Frank and Warren did in late spring, and then the Joe's Garage sessions is when Vinny laid his drums down.
All right, our last track for this collection is Canard du Jour, which is recording dates unknown. It was done at Paramount Studios, Los Angeles, California. I think we can kind of narrow down the recording date, though, don't you?
Yeah, it's sometime in 1972. And if you listen to the song Excentrifugal Force on Apostrophe, which is also recorded in 1972...
really cheap, the way I seen them through the ports, of which there is a half a dozen on the base of my resort. You wouldn't think I'd have too many, since I never cared for sports, but I'm never really lonely in my eccentrifugal port.
You'll hear Frank playing the bouzouki on that track, and then of course the track Canard du Jour, you know, he's featured on the bouzouki for a long time with Jean-Luc Ponty. And as far as I know, that they're from the same exact session.
Well, that wraps up podcast number one of Everything Zappa. Focus on Shut Up and Play Your Guitar. Mike and I want to thank everyone for listening. And as always, please go over to iTunes, give us some reviews, good or bad. It really helps out the podcast a lot. And as always, folks, go get the real deal. All the music Mike and I have been referencing on this podcast can be purchased at www.zappa.com and iTunes. On our next podcast, Mike and I will be discussing three major Zappa compositions, starting with Moe's Vacation, Moe and Herb's Vacation, the third movement of Sinister Footwear, and the amazing The Adventures of Gregory Peckley. So, kiddies, to get yourselves caught up and prepared for the next podcast, run over to the aforementioned places and grab those songs. So here's the deal. If you've attended a Frank Zappa show, email us. That's it, see? fcpodcastmike@yahoo.com. And FC Podcast Mark, that's Mark with a C, at yahoo.com. We would love to hear from you. Specifically, if you got to attend a concert from the era in which we've discussed in the podcast. So tonight, we discussed the 78 to Fall 80 band. If you were fortunate enough to go see that incredible band live, we want to hear from you. On behalf of Mike and I, thanks for listening to the podcast. We hope you enjoyed it, and good night.